And you grew up where?
I grew up until I was 11 in Pike County, Kentucky. And after when I was 11, my father passed. And then we moved from there to McDowell County, West Virginia. And finished pretty much growing up until I was old enough to leave home there.
And what kind of childhood did you have?
Normal, just like any other kid. Your
dad was a pastor as well?
No, he wasn't a pastor. He was just a member of the Lord Jesus Temple in Yeager, West Virginia. My uncle was the pastor, Brady Dawson. Mm.
So it's kind of in the family?
Mm.
Your brother was also?
My brother now, he was a pastor.
Yeah. And the Pentecostal religion is different from Baptist or typical Christian religions in what ways?
We believe in worshiping the Lord. We believe in shouting, speaking in tongues, laying hands on the sick, casting out devils, taking up serpents. If you drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. We just believe the Bible says make a joyful noise unto the Lord. We play our instruments. We try to, what we call press, and we call it press, get in into the Spirit. The Bible said, them that worship me must worship me in spirit, in truth. And you got to press into the Spirit in order to feel the Spirit of God, the power of God. There's a power of God that can heal the sick. And there's the power of God and raise the dead. I mean, that's the kind of God we serve. We serve a mighty God. And we believe in, like I said, praying for the sick, believe in taking up the serpents. If God moves in that way, I'm a little different than some places. I tell all my people that come here to make sure, if they do take up the serpents, to make sure that they feel it's God that's leading them in doing it. Not, I don't want them to do it if it's not of God. And I don't, like I said, I don't tell them they got to. Matter of fact, I tell them if it ain't God, leave them alone, because there's death in this. There's death. And
you lost a couple.
I lost my father died in 83.
From a snake bite?
Yes, sir. And my brother died. We just had he died Memorial weekend in 2000 on that Sunday, Memorial weekend, May 2012.
Those are both during a service?
Yeah, he got bit during the service, and I think he lived around 9 or 10 hours. We always ask when one gets bit if they want to go to the hospital, and if they decide to, you know, that's okay. I mean, you don't know. We try to trust in God, but you don't know. You don't know what you'll do, and you know it's easy to say I will, but until you try, you know. But we don't never make. If one wants to go, we'll take it. You know, it's their choice if they want to try to suffer it out or let whatever happen. We'll pray with them and try to nurse them the best that we can and make them comfortable.
Do you take them to a hospital?
If they desire to. Now, if they don't, we just pray with them and try to make them comfortable. If they're in pain, we'll try to pray for them. And if they're sick, something they think they might can drink to help their sickness as far as settle their stomach. If they want to go, we'll take them. If they don't, we'll do what we can to make them comfortable until the poison runs its course or until they, you know, pass. I mean,
when your father was bitten during a service, did he choose to go to the hospital?
Or? No, he refused medical treatment.
And what about your brother?
He refused medical treatment.
And you've been bitten before, too.
Been bitten 5 times.
5 times.
I've been bit 3 times with a rattler. with Rattlers.
During services?
Yes, and twice with Copperheads. I got bit last May with the Eastern.
And the reason that the Pentecostal snake handling goes on is because in the Bible you
Mark 16:18, Jesus was getting ready to descend into heaven after being crucified. Had the 11 apostles there. Judas was dead, so there wasn't but 11 at that time. And he gave them a commandment. He said, go forth into the world and preach the gospel to all that believe. Them that believe and is baptized shall be saved. Them that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. May not be in order, but thou shalt take up serpents. Thou shalt lay hands on the sick. They shall recover. Thou shalt speak with new tongues. Thou shalt cast out devils. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them.
I saw a bottle of strychnine.
Yes.
Pulpit. So you'll pass out Dixie cups with strychnine?
Like I said, that's another thing. It's not forced. Some people seem to think this is a cult. Nobody's forced to do anything. And there's times that, if we don't know a person, if we don't feel like that they should be doing it, if we believe in living a good, clean, holy life. We believe in being holy and living a clean life. And if we feel like there's someone here that's not living, we won't let them and do things like that, because I've got to watch over one soul. And if I feel like somebody's doing something that the Bible says that they shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven for, and they get bit or drink that poison and die, then I've got to live with that on my conscience. So I try to, for the ones that handle the serpents, I tell them to please do their best to live what the Bible tells them to live.
You're not doing it for shock value. You're doing it because
it's the word. That's it. I didn't write it. I mean, if I'd have wrote it, I'd have left it out. I'm just being obedient. And now, I know this is one of the questions we always get. If it's the word and you're supposed to do it, why do you get bit? And the only answer I can give people on that, well, there's a few. First of all, the Bible said God's ways is not our ways. His thoughts is higher than ours. But we're to be obedient to the word of God. Even we're supposed to love the Lord enough to lay our life down. He said there's no greater love except a man lay down his life for a friend. He's the best friend I ever know. But he told the apostles, he said, you go preach the word. He told them, go preach it to all Creek nations. They went and did what he told them to do. But if you search out in history and according to tradition, Peter was crucified upside down. Paul was beheaded. The Bible tells us that Stephen was stoned to death preaching the word of God, doing what he was told to do, being obedient, but yet he was killed for it. Why did that happen? They was just doing what they was told to do. And that's the way we look at it with this. We don't know. We know people think we do this and think we can't get bit. And that's not true at all. We know there's a change. Every time we go in a box, we know there's a change that we can get bit. And we also know there's a chance that we could die. But we want to be willing to be obedient to the word. If we feel that God is leading us to do that, we want to be obedient to that. And we want to be willing to give our life if asked. And like I said, we all get weak in faith. If one does go to the hospital, we don't put it down. We don't put it down. Don't look down on nobody. But that's the best answer I can give him. I don't know why he would tell us to take him up and then turn around and a lot of times we get bit. People get bit because they get ahead of God. They just move out and get ahead of God. But there, you know, I still believe there's times even in the will of God you can get bit. If it was prophesied that my dad would die, he didn't say who would die. It was just prophesied that a son would die. And that was prophesied I don't know how many times, about for a solid 2 months, about every weekend somebody would get in the spirit and prophesy that a son was going to die. And when I remember, I was just a kid, but I could remember the church a talking, wonder who's going to die, you know. But and then my father got bit that Sunday, and like I said, he lived right at 10 hours. But you know, I know a lot of people think that's foolish, but my dad was a bad alcoholic, bad. Lived a bad life. And I seen him as a young man, young child, give his heart to God. And I seen a man that was an alcoholic, mean, that beat on his kids and whooped us. And like I said, now I never got a whooping. I don't believe that I didn't deserve, but I just believe due to his alcohol abuse that he went a little overboard many a time. And I seen that man change when he gave his heart to God. To totally, he never drunk another drop after that. He never smoked another cigarette. He gave, never cussing. I mean, he was just, I seen a man that was filled with love. And not only did it change his life for the better on that part, but he found something that he loved so much that he was willing to give his life for. And my brother passed 8 years ago used to say, if it ain't worth dying for, it ain't worth living for. And I guess that's about the truth of things, you know. If it ain't worth dying for, it ain't worth living for. And I know a lot of people think we're foolish, but like I said, I don't force it on nobody. And what gets me, I guess, about our faith is there's different churches all up and down this road here, Baptist, Church of God, and I don't put none of them down. I don't go in their church, or I don't go on their Facebook page and begin to make comments. If you don't believe like I do, if you don't take up serpents, you're going to go to hell, or you're stupid. But yet, those people don't care to come on my Facebook page or in person and tell me I'm foolish, I'm stupid, I'm ignorant. And that's the part I guess I don't understand. We all supposed to be serving the Lord. We're all trying to get to heaven. We're all working on the same goal here. Maybe you're doing it a little different than I am, but we're still supposed to. He said, how will they know? Jesus said, how will they know, talking about the world, that you are my disciples? He said, if you love one another, we're to love each other. We're not to speak evil of one another, put each other down, talk bad about them. We're not to do that. And, you know, I've been hurt many a time, but that's all right, too. But I try to never go, regardless of how, even when my brother died, regardless how people felt, regardless to the ones that thought he was ignorant, he had family that was alive and hurting, but they didn't care. They went on there and put us down like dogs anyways. And I said, you know, I would never do that to nobody. And what gets me, you take somebody that maybe get out here and OD on drugs, you'll see people saying, rest in peace. You don't see nobody going on there telling that family how ignorant them people was for, but yet somebody give their life for what they believe, and yet we're foolish, we're ignorant, and we're stupid. Our faith is probably persecuted the worst of any Christian faith that they are. But that's all right, too. I mean, the Bible tells us that we'd be hated by all nations. So, for his name's sake.
Has the strychnine poisoned anyone? Have people had reactions to that?
Oh, yeah. There's been a few die. Not very many, but some. Well, I've had it, effects from it. It sets up what you call that. Is it called rigor mortis?
Rigor mortis?
Yeah. That's what happens. It begins to, your joints and stuff, it locks you up and draws you up real, like the few times that I've drunk it, there's times that it's I've got so stiff I couldn't walk. It's like I couldn't even bend my legs. And it just, like I said, it locks you up. You're just, and I believe, honestly, I tell people, if I'd have lost my faith, if I'd have thought, oh, you're going to die, you've had it. I may very well have died, but when I've got like that, I just tell myself, it's the word of God. He said, if we drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt us. We've got to believe that regardless. He said, this is a faith thing, not a feel thing. He said, we walk by faith and not by sight. So when them times come, you just got to believe what the word of God says. You've got to believe it with all your heart. But as of up to this point, I've had effects last that time. I'd say about the longest it's ever bothered me, about 15 or 20 minutes. Like I said, I got to where I couldn't walk, and I just kept speaking to myself faith that it was the word, and I believe it, and about 20 minutes, and I was fine. But like, now there have been some that's died from it. But I tell people, now that is, it does say with the strychnine, or not just strychnine, poison. If you drink anything deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. But now, he didn't tell us that snake wouldn't bite us. He said, take them up. But.
So the Pentecostal religion is, the man is considered the head of the household.
Right.
And the women are, tell me about the relationship between a man and his
well,
wife.
Well, at this church, it ain't, like I said, people, I'm just telling you what the Bible says. And it's up to one to believe whether the Bible's correct or whether they don't. The Bible said that for the man to be the head of his house, to love his wife as Christ did the church. I don't believe in mistreating your wife. I believe in loving your wife. But he is the head of the house. And as far as church, it tells us, he said, Paul told us, for he said, I subject a woman not to teach or usurp authority over a man. If she need to learn anything, ask of her husband at home. I don't believe in, now when it says a subject woman not to teach and not to speak, that's talking about a speaker. We don't believe in letting a woman preach here, but I don't have a problem with a woman singing, testifying, those things. She just, according to the scripture, now if she wants to teach the younger women, that's fine too. Because the Bible says for the elderly women to teach the younger women how to be wise. That's the word. That's what the word tells us. How to be wise under their husbands. So I don't have a problem with if there's a elderly woman would like to have a day to teach the younger women. But I'm just saying, according to the word, a woman cannot have authority to preach or teach to the men. It was not so from the beginning. It ain't that I wrote it. I mean, I've got a mother that's been in this for about my whole life, as far as back as I can remember. Love to be able to say preach, but I can't because the word says she can't. It ain't that I choose not to. I just got to be able to do what the word tells us. I've got to follow the word at the very best of my ability. Like I said, I'm sure we all got we come up short. Somewhere, all of us has come up short. But that's where the mercy and the grace and the blood of Jesus applies then.
And women are allowed or not allowed to cut their hair?
Well, they're allowed to do what they want to. But I don't, I mean, it's down. There ain't nobody, but this, I preach that it's wrong. Like I said, I can't, Peter said we can't rule over God's heritage. All I can do is preach you what the Word says, and the Bible says, for a woman's hair is her glory. For her, if she be shorn, let her also be shaven. Then it goes on to say, we believe here our women wears veils. The veils, because it says, then it goes on to say, if she be neither shorn nor shaven, then let her also be covered. Talking about a veil when she pray or prophesies. We believe when a woman's in praying, or if she's basically in church praying or prophesying, she's to cover her head with a veil. It shows humility, and it also shows that, according to the scriptures, that she's honoring her husband by showing she's the weaker vessel.
And she also wears a dress at all times?
All times. Yeah. You're supposed to. Like I said, I mean, I can't force nobody to do nothing. And I'm different than a lot of people in my faith. A lot of people in my faith trust. But I want, first of all, without love, I don't care how you live. The Bible, love, without love, we ain't going. We got to have the love of God. And the Bible I read, Jesus sat right down amongst the sinners, eat with them, drunk with them. And I tell people here, all I can do is preach you what the Word says. But I can't make nobody live it. And I'm not going to run nobody off if they don't. Because the house of God's where we need to be. We're all sick. We are. That's why we come. We're sick. And we're looking for help. That's why you come to church. And I preach what the Bible says. And I tell them that they need not do it. But if one does it, I don't run them off. I'm not mean to them, and I don't treat them bad. I treat them just like everybody else. I shake their hand. I'm good to them because I want to show them the love of God. Regardless, I want them to know that I love them as a person. And if they're doing something that the Bible's wrong, hey. It takes God to help give anything up. If we could do anything in ourselves, then Jesus wouldn't have had to come and die. But he's seen that we couldn't live the law. He's seen it was impossible. So God sent his only begotten Son to die so we could send us a comforter to help us live what the Bible tells us to live. But it also says if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. So I tell people you need to live what the Word says. You need to live it the best of your ability. But if you slip and make a mistake, you can repent, get forgiveness for that mistake. I just tell them you can't, like I said, I don't believe you can go to the bar tonight and get drunk, get up more and ask for forgiveness and then turn around and do the same thing over and over and over because that's not being sorry for what you done. Sorry for what you done is when you repent and you don't do it no more.
Have you seen healings? And?
Oh, yeah. I've seen my dad. He was possessed. I know people would say, I know what I know, and that's all that matters to me. That's like my taking up serpents. I don't force it on nobody, and I don't argue with nobody because I know what I know, and that's all that matters to me. When my dad come to the altar and he was possessed, that man, his eyes broke back in his head and all you could see was the whites of his eyes. And he backed up in the corner and he began to beat on the door of the church. He was in, first he was in the corner and he'd rub his legs like this right here, and he was laughing, and he was speaking in a voice, and he was saying, "I told you not to come. I told you not to come," and he was rubbing his legs like that, laughing. And then he turned around and he started beating on that door. And his hands, oh man, the meat, it was just awful. He just, he beat a solid oak door, plumb off, plumb down. And the church kept praying and just kept praying. And then I don't know how, it probably went a couple hours like it. And then all of a sudden, he began to throw up. And now, I don't know if this is true, but in the middle of that, when he threw up, it was like a foam. And in the middle of that foam, there was seven big chunks about that big around that was like white. They just big old chunks like that. And they said that each one of them represented a devil. And if so, he had seven devils. But now, like I said, I don't know about all that. It's possible. And I've been healed several times. I was in a car wreck, broke his ribs down his side. And that was not long after that brother of mine had passed. And my mom knowed I'd been in a car wreck, but I didn't want to worry her. And she asked me, was I all right? And I said, well, I've got a cut above my head. And I said, my foot, I said, I've hurt my foot, but I never mentioned a thing about my ribs. I just didn't want her to worry. And got ready a few days later, I got ready for church. And it was about all I could do. I mean, I hurt so bad. I don't know if anybody's ever had broke ribs, but they hurt. And I couldn't hardly, it hurt to breathe, much less try to get dressed. And I get dressed. And my wife, now she don't go to church with me. I go to church. I mean, I couldn't even hardly raise my hands up to praise the Lord. And church got started. And just in a few minutes when church, there was a woman came, got me, and laid her hand right there and began to speak in tongues. And immediately my pain left and I was fine. I went home at night. I was doing all this right here. I told my wife, I said, God healed me. And I mean, that was it. I never hurt another day. I had hepatitis C from a drug addiction years ago before I gave my heart to God. I packed that, had that. I had got so bad, I didn't go get treatment because at the time, the only treatment they had, they told me, that after I did treatment, about 4 days, I'd be definitely sick. And I said, well, I gotta work. I can't. So I put off treatment. And I had got so bad, so it got to where I'd get up and I'd be sick. And I felt like I was 300-400 degrees hot. I'd crawl outside and lay on the sidewalk to cool off. And I finally told the church and stuff, I told him, I said, I'm going to go get treatment. I said, because I just can't take this no more. Because I was trusting in God to heal me. But I also said, well, you know, this is something I brought on myself. So if he don't heal me, it ain't like he's lying. He has to, because I did it to myself anyways. But go to the doctor. They started some tests and this test showed and comes back, yeah, you got it, which I, like I said, I already knew. He said, we're going to do some more tests. He said, there's more tests we got to do. I come to church, spirit fell, same thing, a woman come up, began to speak in tongues, put her hands right about where the liver's at on the body. I stood up, after she done, I knew in myself, I said, God's healed me. I told the church, I said, I'm claiming my healing. I said, I believe God's moved and I want God to heal me. Go to that specialist. He does more tests. Still says, I've got it. I said, I tell the church, I said, well, the doctor's saying I got it. I said, but I still say I'm healed. I went back for the last test and we was going to start treatment. I go in there and I sit down, and he's got all the test results back, that last test. He said, I got good news for you, and I got bad news. I said, well, let's hear it. He said, the bad news is you did have hepatitis C. He said, but the good news is you don't have it no more. He said, the paperwork I've got here shows me here you had it. What I've got here says it's nowhere to be found. I jumped up off that table and I said, praise the Lord. And he said, well, I wouldn't get religious about it. I said, you don't have to, brother, I will. I said, God's healed me. And I had a brother come here at, he got the church to pray for him. He got to where he couldn't, every time he'd eat, he couldn't hold it down. He'd start throwing it up, and he lost, seemed like he said he lost like 30 pounds in just like a month. And he said he wanted us to pray. We prayed for him, and spirit moved pretty good. And I felt like then that he got healed, but I wanted him to realize he had got healed. And he come back in the next Sunday and testified that God had healed him, that he hadn't thrown up another time since, you know, we prayed. So, see, that's a lot of people think we're crazy or look and think it's something when they see us handling serpents. But I want to tell the world, that ain't no miracle, handling a serpent. The miracle to me is you take a drug addict. For me, I was on drugs for years. Mama couldn't love it out of me. The rehab centers couldn't get it out of me. But when I gave my heart to God, he set me free. I come up from that altar set free from an addiction of cocaine. Smoking it, you name it, any way it could be done, I did it, and I was hooked. I was hooked bad, and within 3 years, I lost a business, my own business. Went through over $100,000, and God set me free. I come up from that altar. To me, that was the best miracle. That's far more greater than to me than handling a rattlesnake. When I can see, when you know, you get somebody come to this, to the altar, that's bound from addiction or bound from depression, bound by things, and God set them free, that is a miracle. That is far greater a miracle to me than anybody ever taking up a rattlesnake. But we serve a God that has all power, all power. People, I was telling you earlier, and it's like I said, in the beginning, when it comes to taking up serpents, in the beginning, God told Adam, he said, I give you dominion over all things. There was no such thing as fear. Adam named all the animals. Even in the millennial reign, the Bible says that the lion will lay with the lamb, the child will be able to play on a den of... What is it basically saying?